Really nice to be here, and thanks so much for having me. I actually had goose pimples or goose bumps watching that and listening to that, and I said to myself, do I actually have to get up? Could I not just listen to three or four more of those songs? I'm really excited to be here. And on the drive down, I'm from Clare, but on the drive down, I was thinking a lot about why am I here? Like, why do I do what I do? Why do I believe in young people so much? And then when I walked in and saw the energy of this room and of this group of people, I know very well why I'm here. So I have 15 minutes, and what I was going to do is I was going to tell you a little story. Remember when you were a kid and you were in school, or maybe you still are, and in the afternoon when you're in primary school, you'd be told a story. It was my favorite time of the day. That's what I'd like to do for a few minutes. And the story I'd like to tell you is a little bit about who I am and why we set up SOAR. And basically, that was what I was going to cover. Is that okay? Nice. So I'm from the west of Ireland, from Clare. My mum and dad were really hard-working people. They both worked really hard to put seven of us through college, and both of them hadn't ever been out of secondary school themselves. My dad had never been out of primary school. And as a teenager, I was a really shy kid. I was covered in acne. I didn't think I'd ever meet a girl that would like me. And I was terribly insecure of myself. I'd walk into a room and I think everyone in the room was looking at me and thought I was awful. The one thing that kept me going was hurling, a sport I loved since I was tiny. And when I was 13, 14, I started playing with the county team in Clare. I did that till I was 28. It was a dream come true to run out in Croke Park in front of 82,000 people and hear that roar and then have to respond to that pressure. But when I was 24, I decided to give it up for a few years, and I went and relocated to Nova Scotia, Canada, and went to university there. While I was there, probably my best friend in the world, my number one supporter, passed away, and that was my dad, Jerome. He'd had a long battle, well, a nine-month battle, it felt much longer than that, with cancer, and he died the morning that I was due to fly back and see him, and I didn't get back in time. My six brothers and sisters were there and said goodbye to him, and it's probably my greatest regret that I didn't get to see him at that final moment, because he was always my number one supporter. Never told me in my adult life that he loved me, but I knew more than anything that he did. After that, I went through a very difficult time. I used to always hide this and never speak about it, but I went through a period of depression for around 2 years. I didn't know what it was. I was a real macho guy. You never let your guard down. You never showed weakness. But I needed to do something with this sense of loss. So I got in, this probably wasn't the most sensible thing in the world to do, but I got in a bicycle on one side of Canada, and I kept cycling till I got to the other side, which is 7,000 kilometers. It's like, yeah, I know exactly. It's like cycling from Dublin to Moscow and back. And it was an absolutely amazing journey. I got to meet every day people who were, you know, challenged by life and trying to do their best. And on the very last day, as we cycled from Dublin to Ennis, 5,000 people lined up in Ennis to welcome me back. But one person in particular was there. I didn't know her at the time, and she's now my wife. And our little boy, Jerome, named after my father, is four now. And this morning, we had a disco in the kitchen before I dropped him to play school. My way out of that really difficult patch was, one evening I was sitting at home in my sister's home in Ennis. Everyone has someone that they can feel okay around. Sometimes, if we're lucky, we have more than one. Some people don't even have one, but that's kind of what you do. You make people feel okay about themselves, and you keep them safe, and you keep them, try and get them on the road. That person for me was Rosalind, my sister. Every evening when I'd be coming home to Rosalind's house, I used to pass a bunch of fellas, 15, 16, standing under a street light. And everyone in the estate used to be half afraid of these young fellas. And I was too, a little, always there in the dark with their hoods up. And one day I said, I'm not going to keep walking past them. And I got chatting to them. And I asked them, what's your story? And I discovered these were really beautiful young men that just didn't have much to do and nowhere to go. A few weeks later, I saw this clip. Johnny's going to play it for you. And this changed everything for me.
How much time? Forest Keep, Niverpied, comes across, wins a brown line.
I was probably addicted to anything exciting. Then I took on the role as president of Melbourne Footy Club. So I was getting a bit consumed, and it was probably a bit too much of the ego.
Demon President Jimmy Steins, good to have you with us, Jim.
Since assuming control of the presidency last year, Jim Steins has re-energised the Demons. Today, though, that energy was replaced with raw emotion.
Yeah. Try and get through this in one piece. I heard the initial diagnosis, which was, Jim, you've got cancer in a number of places in your body. This neurosurgeon went and tested me, and he said, look, we've got to get you in and get another scan. And
apparently on the scan you had yesterday, there's a new one that's close to...
Seriously?
Yeah, little one that's a little bit like this too. There's one there and there's one there.
He's had three massive temazepam tablets, 10 milligrams each. I don't want to see your ass.
No, don't see my ass.
Just suck a ball. Just throw the ball. Oh!
That didn't work, did it?
No one inside, no alibi. We fade in faster than speed light.
Because I've often said to him, you just can't leave me here on my own to do this. Because he was always, you know, he's the one there at the end of the day when I'm a mess. And
you know who's at home watching this game sitting up in his bed? Jimmy Steins is watching. What is what missing? What missing you get upset in this last quarter?
When faced with death, the ego just drops its barriers. I needed to live a better life, and getting cancer has led me to a much better life.
When I saw that, something inside me stirred, because it showed this big 6'5" Irishman that had travelled to the other side of the world and had created an organisation. Yes, he'd become an Aussie Rules star and a household name in Australia. And if you go to Melbourne now, there's a 9-foot statue of him. Kind of exaggerated his height a little bit. But what fascinated me most was he'd created an organisation for teenagers, where for all teenagers they could come into a room and discover what it means to be alive. Because the reality is, whether you're an adult in this room or you're a young person, you're going through your own journey in life. We all are. And that has ups and downs. And sometimes all it needs is a place you can go to make sense of that. And for those that perhaps don't have that, things can sometimes get off the rails. So when I saw that, I said, I want to create something. I sold my car. I traveled to Melbourne. My wife-to-be thought I was absolutely insane. But then she'd met me on the last day of something that seemed insane, so she kind of got it. And I asked these guys, could we bring Jim Steins' organization, Reach, back to Ireland? At the time, he was dying. He died not long after that documentary was made. So they weren't very enthusiastic, but I met people here in Ireland that were. People that really wanted to support change. This was 2010. Since then, SOAR's worked with around 40,000 teenagers in schools and communities all over Ireland. And I'm new to working with young people. There's people in this room that have been doing it for many years, so I do not profess to know how to do it properly. But what I do know is we have met young people who have blown my mind. They blow my mind with their courage, with their sense of possibility. The very things as adults sometimes we can lose as we get older, because maybe sometimes we get our hearts broken along the way. But I've met young people that are still inspired to go out and change their world and change their world. And it has been utterly inspiring as someone who started with a tiny little dream to do something to complement a lot of the great work you guys do.